Hi everyone, today I'm going to present a practical methodology for the generation of a reliable prism layer mesh for your CFD simulations. As can be seen here, the prism layer mesh is a set of orthogonal prismatic cells which is used to capture the boundary layer close to a wall. To understand the importance of the use of the prism layer mesh, note that when a fluid is flowing close to a wall, strong gradients are imposed on the mean and fluctuating velocity components, as schematically shown here. Here, y plus is the non-dimensional wall distance. These strong gradients are the results of both the no-slip boundary condition at the wall, which imposes zero velocity value at the surface, and the wall damping effect on turbulence, which causes the velocity fluctuations go to zero at the wall, as shown here. Therefore, to accurately capture these strong gradients of mean and fluctuating velocity components close to the wall, the use of prism layer mesh, as shown here, is recommended. Now let's see how we can generate the prism layer mesh. In every commercial or open source CFD code, to generate the prism layer mesh, the following three parameters can be used to completely express the prism layer mesh: thickness of the prism layer stretching factor, number of layers. All these three parameters are shown here in this figure for a prism layer mesh. Here we have M layers. We can see the thickness of the prism layer here. And finally, prism layer stretching factor, which is shown here by R. Note that X here is the first layer thickness immediately next to the wall. Now let's see how we can generate the prism layer mesh using these three parameters. Let's discuss how we can calculate the prism layer thickness. Ideally, the prism layers must cover the entire boundary layer on a wall. For instance, here in this figure, we can see the boundary layer close to a wall. The prism layer mesh should cover the whole boundary layer as shown here. So the prism layer total thickness must have the same height as the boundary layer. Therefore, to specify the prism layer thickness, this equation proposed by White 2006 to estimate the boundary layer thickness for a turbulent flow over a flat plate can be used. In this equation, delta is the prism layer thickness, L is the characteristic length of the body, and REL is the length-based Reynolds number. Note that using this equation, we are assuming that the prism layer thickness is equal to the thickness of the boundary layer, which is a valid assumption. Now, let's see how we can estimate the number of layers. For this purpose, a geometric progression is used in almost all the CFD codes to establish a relationship between the prism layer thickness, number of layers, and prism layer stretching factor. Therefore, using a geometric progression, the relationship between the prism layer thickness delta, number of layers m, and prism layer stretching factor r can be written as we can see here. Here, delta is the prism layer thickness, x is the thickness of the first layer immediately next to the wall as shown here, m is the number of layers, and r is the prism layer stretching factor. Thus, by manipulating this equation, we can obtain this relation to obtain the number of layers m. Here, ln is the natural logarithm. Therefore, we need to estimate the first layer thickness x in order to obtain the value of m, which is the number of layers. Note that we have already assumed that the prism layer thickness delta is equal to the boundary layer thickness. The first layer thickness x depends on the target y plus value of the problem, which in return is strongly tied to the choice of the turbulence model and the flow field we are interested in capturing. We can elect to resolve the complete profile of the boundary layer, or alternatively we can make use of empirical wall functions to reduce the cell count. The y plus is defined as follows, as shown here, in terms of the first layer thickness x. Here nu indicates the kinematic viscosity and u asterisk is the reference velocity or friction velocity, which can be defined using the wall shear stress tau w as shown here. Note that the y plus is the non-dimensional distance of the cell center to the wall, while x here is the first cell thickness, as we can see here. As you may know, the turbulence models use two common approaches to capture the boundary layer near the surface of a body. The first approach, which is also referred to as low y plus wall treatment, is using a very fine mesh with a high resolution to resolve the fluid flow characteristics within the boundary layer. And the second one, which is also referred to as high y plus wall treatment, is using a coarser mesh to employ the standard wall functions. Okay, in the first approach, where no wall functions are used, the center of the first cell immediately next to the wall should lay within the viscous sublayer of the boundary layer, which is equivalent to a y plus value less than 1 as shown here. While in the second approach, where wall functions are used, the center of the first cell immediately next to the wall should lay within the logarithmic region of the boundary layer, okay, which is equivalent to a y plus value between 30 and 500, as we can see here. The first approach provides a more accurate resolution of the boundary layer for certain simulations, such as flows with strong wall-bounded effects. This resolution is absolutely necessary. For other simulations, the added computational cost is not always justifiable. To gain more information about the wall treatment used by each turbulence model, you can watch the video in my channel entitled RAN's Turbulence Models, Which Should I Choose? So to estimate the first layer thickness x for the target y plus value, this equation proposed by White 2006 for turbulent flows over a flat plate can be employed. Okay, here x is the first layer thickness and nu is the kinematic viscosity, u is the free stream velocity, ln is the natural logarithm, and rel is the length based Reynolds number. Now let's review the methods by which we can calculate the three main parameters for the generation of the prism layer mesh. Thickness of the prism layer. This parameter is estimated using the following equation as shown here. Number of layers. This parameter is estimated as shown here, where the first layer thickness x is estimated for the target y plus value using this equation. And finally, we have the prism layer stretching factor r. This parameter is directly specified by the user. It is recommended to use a value from 1.05 to 1.2. To assess the accuracy of the methodology presented here for the generation of the prism layer mesh, I'm going to prepare a CFD simulation for a simple geometry, which is a 6-to-1 prolate spheroid, as shown here. In this simulation, the prism layer mesh will be generated using the method explained in the present video. The purpose here is judging the accuracy of the method presented in the the current video for the generation of the prism layer mesh. We can do this by comparing the characteristics of the boundary layer obtained from the CFD simulation with those that are in fact estimated for the prism layer mesh using the method presented in this video. The simulation will be set up within the CFD software Star CCM Plus. Here I'm not going to go into detail about how to set up the CFD simulation. As can be seen here, the prolate spheroid has an angle of incidence equal to 20 degrees with respect to an inflow with a constant velocity of 47.957 meter per second. So knowing the length of the geometry, free stream velocity, kinematic viscosity and length based Reynolds number as shown here and also shown here in this figure, we can calculate the values of the three parameters of the prism layer mesh as presented here in this table. Note that the simulation setup is performed for two different values of Y plus. As you can see here, Y plus equals 1 is equivalent to the case where no valve functions will be used by the turbulence model, and as can be inferred in this case more layers are needed in the prism layer mesh, while Y plus equals 100 is equivalent to the case where valve functions will be used by the turbulence model, and as we can see here in this case much less layers are needed in the prism layer mesh. These values are used to generate the prism layer mesh for the CFD simulation. Two simulations are set up, one simulation where the Y plus value is around 1, which we are going to call it the fine mesh, and the second simulation where the Y plus value is around 100, which we are going to call it the coarse mesh. Okay, these figures show the fine and coarse grids which are generated using the values estimated earlier for the prism layer mesh. As can be seen, the fine mesh here contains much more layers in the prism layer mesh close to the body surface, which offers a much higher resolution compared to the coarse mesh. These figures show the Y plus distribution over the body surface obtained from the CFD simulations. This figure shows the Y plus distribution over the body surface for the coarse mesh, in which the target Y plus value has been set as 100. As can be seen, the maximum Y plus value encountered over the body surface is very close to 100. However, there are some regions where the Y plus is significantly smaller than 30. The reason why we have Y plus values smaller than 30 is because the Y plus is in fact a flow dependent quality. So it is difficult to ensure a fixed Y plus value larger than 30 for all the near wall cells. This is going to cause a problem since the use of valve functions is only valid for Y plus values larger than 30. That is why it is recommended to use a turbulence model with an all Y plus wall treatment whenever possible, since this kind of turbulence models adopts an appropriate wall treatment based on the Y plus value. This figure shows the Y plus distribution over the body surface for the fine mesh, in which the target Y plus value has been set as 1. As can be seen, the maximum Y plus value encountered over the body surface is very close to 1. However, again, as can be observed in this figure, there are some regions where the Y plus is significantly smaller than 1. Note that in case of the fine mesh, where no valve functions are used, the Y plus variation over the body surface is not going to cause any problem as long as the y plus values remain smaller than 1. Now let's see if the prism layer mesh is covering the entire boundary layer close to the body's surface. We can do this by visualizing the magnitude of the flow velocity vectors along a line normal to the body's surface in the region inside this red rectangular as shown here. Note that this visualization is performed for the fine mesh. Okay, in this figure we can see the prism layer mesh close to the body surface and the magnitude of the velocity vectors of the fluid flow inside the prism layer mesh. Okay, the velocity vectors are shown using these arrows, considering that the velocity vectors have reached the free stream velocity based on the velocity magnitude shown here. It can be concluded that the thickness we have estimated for the prism layer mesh have completely covered the boundary layer close to the body surface. To visualize more closely the development of the boundary layer near the body surface, the magnitude of the velocity vectors normal to the body surface will be shown inside this red rectangular as shown here. Okay, as can be observed here in this figure, the magnitude of the velocity vectors drops rapidly toward the wall, which is due to the no slip boundary condition imposed over the body's surface. Okay, this this boundary condition causes the mean velocity components experience a strong gradient close to the wall or the body's surface. This is the end of this video. I hope you found this video useful. Please let me know what you think about this video by leaving a comment in the comment section. Thank you for watching the video, and for further upcoming videos, please subscribe to this channel.